In the name of Jesus, we welcome one and all as we gather for worship on this chilly winter weekend. My name is Bob Maciejewski, and leading us in prayer is Father Steve. In observance of World Marriage Day, we are honoring the married couples of our own parish. Our presider will impart a blessing to them as we pray that their faithful love will continue to be a blessing to all of us. Within the very compassion of God, Jesus reached out to the broken, even to lepers, with a healing touch. Let us allow Jesus to touch us in our liturgy today and to show us the way of love. We begin our worship now in song, raising our voices with the hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, found in your program. But first, let us stand to greet one another in the Lord.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. My brothers and sisters, we come here on one of the first days in a while that has felt and looked like winter out here. We come to give our hearts and our minds over to our Heavenly Father as we celebrate World Weekend of Marriage. We celebrate the love that exists in marriage, the love that God calls us to give back to Him. Acknowledging that there are times in our lives that we don't love the Lord how we should, we come to Him and ask Him to forgive us. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, to people of goodwill. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ. With the Holy Spirit in the glory of God the Father. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill.
Let us pray. O God, who teach us that you abide in hearts that are just and true, grant that we may be so fashioned by your grace as to become a dwelling pleasing to you, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of Leviticus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron, if someone has on his skin a scab or a pustule or a blotch, which appears to be the sore of leprosy, he shall be brought to Aaron, the priest, or one of the priests among his descendants. If the man is leprous and unclean, the priest shall declare him unclean by reason of the sore on his head. The one who bears the sore of leprosy shall keep his garments rent and his head bare, and shall muffle his beard. He shall cry out, unclean, unclean. As long as the sore is on him, he shall declare himself unclean, since he is, in fact, unclean. He shall dwell apart, making his abode outside the camp. The word of the Lord.
to you in time of trouble. And you fill me with the joy of salvation.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do everything for the glory of God. Avoid giving offense, whether to the Jews or the Greeks or our church of God. Just as I try to please everyone in every way, not seeking my own benefit, but that of the many, that they may be saved. Be imitators of me, as I am of Christ, the word of the Lord.
Be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. A leper came to Jesus, and kneeling down, begged him and said, "If you wish, you can make me clean." Moved with pity, he stretched out his hand, touched him, and said to him, "I do will it, be made clean." The leprosy left him immediately, and he was made clean. Then, warning him sternly, he dismissed him at once. He said to him, "See that you tell no one anything, but go, show yourself to the priest, and offer for your cleansing what Moses prescribed. That will be proof for them." The man went away and began to publicize the whole manner. He spread the report abroad so that it was impossible for Jesus to enter a town openly. He remained outside in deserted places, and people kept coming to him from everywhere. The Gospel of the Lord. I think we as humans are really hardwired to share good news. When we get good news, it's almost impossible for us to keep it to ourselves. Think about when a young couple gets engaged, how happy they are, how much they want to share that with other people. Think about when a woman is expecting a child, how joyful an occasion that is, how they want to share that. I think about when the Tigers signed Prince Fielder. It wasn't an hour after it reported, and I got a couple of phone calls, some text messages. I wanted to share it with other people as well. People want to share good news. It's part of who we are. In the gospel today, we come across this very bold leper. Right? This leper is not a timid man. He's a man of great boldness. As a leper, he's supposed to stay away from people. We heard in the first reading that whenever people approach, the leper is supposed to call out, "Unclean, unclean," supposed to warn everyone that someone unclean is nearby. But yet, this leper has very bold faith in what he says to Jesus. He says, "If you will it, if you want to, you can make me clean." You see, that faith moves his actions as well. He comes close to Jesus. He kneels down in great faith, in great submission to the power and the authority and the goodness of Jesus. And we see what Jesus' response to his boldness is. We hear, this is really the first time in the Gospel of Mark, we hear about some emotion of Jesus. And it's an emotional response to this leper's faith. We see Jesus is moved with pity. And even more than that, Jesus stretches out his hand and touches him. That may seem like just something to pass over in the gospel, because Jesus is always touching everyone, healing people through touch. But think about a leper who has this very contagious disease. And the concept at the time, the Jewish law, was that when someone clean or something clean touches someone or something unclean, it becomes unclean. But that's not what happens with Jesus. Jesus, who is perfectly clean, touches the unclean leper, and he becomes clean. He passes on his cleanliness, his goodness, his God's love onto this leper. And then this weird passage that Jesus tells him, very hard, I think, for some of us to understand, says, "Don't tell anyone about this. Keep this to yourself. And just go and fulfill the Mosaic law. Go and do what Moses has told the Jewish people for hundreds and hundreds of years in the law, how they are to prove that they're clean. Go before a priest and show yourself to him to show that you're clean, offer a sacrifice to God." There was great misunderstanding at the time about what and who the Messiah would be. Right? Everyone was looking for a triumphant king in the line of David, like David, to come and conquer the enemies of Israel, to come and be a military Messiah, a military conqueror. And that's not at all who Jesus is. We see time and time again, and we'll come across this in Mark's gospel as well, that when Jesus tells his disciples what's going to happen, when he tells those who are closest to him, those who have the power and the authority to go out and heal as well, when he tells them what kind of Messiah he's going to be, they don't get it at all. So Jesus knows that people are not going to understand. The time is not right to show forth his kingship, to show forth that he is the Son of God. So he tells him, tell no one. And what does the man do? Does the exact opposite. He goes out and he tells everyone. He began to publicize it abroad, we hear in the gospel. And he can't hold it in. This good news of Jesus can't stay inside him. It's kind of like a secret, right? When someone tells us a secret, sometimes it's really hard to keep that inside us. Well, this man can't keep it inside him and goes out and tells everyone. When he goes out and tells them, people hear, and they say, I want to find out who this guy is. I want to meet this Jesus. I want to encounter this Jesus. Brothers and sisters, this is what the Catholic Church does. The Catholic Church can't keep inside of her the good news that God has shared. Can't keep inside of her the good news of Jesus Christ. She is compelled to share that good news. It flows out of the church in every way. Flows out of the church through preaching, through coming here and worshiping and coming to know God, through other ways that the word is made known, through Catholic television, through Catholic radio, through other ways that people go out and speak the good news, preach the word of God. And it also flows out, this good news flows out of the Catholic Church through her actions of love. Catholic schools and universities, Catholic hospitals and nursing homes, Catholic charities and outreaches to the poor and vulnerable. I think it's especially important to remember how important the women religious in our country and in our world have been at these forms of outreach, at starting schools, at building hospitals and nursing homes, and caring for those who are marginalized and the smallest of our society. These things that the church does are not on the sides or peripheral to the mission of the church. It's who she is. It's at the very heart of what she is. To go out and proclaim the dignity of life, to go out and protect and to serve those who are most in need. These things, my brothers and sisters, are at the core of what the mission of the church is. And they're a huge part of the mission, both now and from the very beginning of the church. Over the past few weeks, we have seen that these institutions have been put in a very precarious situation regarding certain aspects of healthcare, where these religious institutions would be forced not only to provide, but also pay for certain aspects of healthcare. Many of our bishops across the country have spoken out against this, and our own Archbishop, His Excellency Alan Vigneron, has written a letter, and he asked all the priests of the diocese to share this letter with all the people of our diocese. Archbishop Vigneron writes, "Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I write to you concerning an alarming and serious threat to religious liberty in the United States. Under the First Amendment to the Constitution, we should be left free to love God according to our conscience. The government should not force us to choose between violating our consciences and violating the law. And yet the federal government has just dealt a heavy blow to the fundamental right of religious liberty for all citizens of any faith. The U.S. Department of Health and Human Services announced last month that almost all employers, including Catholic and other religious employers, will be forced to offer their employees health coverage that includes sterilization, abortion-inducing drugs, and contraception. Almost all health insurers will be forced to include those services in their health policies they write, and almost all individuals will be forced to buy that coverage as a part of their policy. The administration's sole concession was to give our institutions 1 year to comply. As a result, unless the rule is overturned, we Catholics will be compelled either to violate our consciences or to drop health coverage for our employees and suffer the penalties for doing so. Shockingly, the administration has adopted a definition of religion so narrow that it would force us only to offer charity to those who are Catholic. Under the administration's logic, we would have to ask people for their baptismal certificate before we allow them to enter one of our soup kitchens. Surely one could not claim that Mother Teresa was engaged in religion only when she was in the chapel and not when she reached out to others in whom she saw the face of Christ. Yet this is the meaning of the administration's definition of religion. We cannot, we will not comply with this unjust law. This is not just a Catholic issue. Rather, this decision affects religious believers of all traditions. We are already joined by our brothers and sisters of all faiths and many others of goodwill in this important effort to regain our religious freedom. In generations past, the Church has always been able to count on the faithful to stand up and protect her sacred rights and duties. I call upon this generation of the faithful of the Archdiocese of Detroit to do the same. Our children and grandchildren deserve nothing less. I would ask of you two things. First, as a community of faith, we must commit ourselves to prayer and fasting that wisdom and justice may prevail and religious liberty may be restored. And second, I would also recommend visiting the website www.usccb.org/conscience to learn more about this issue and how to contact Congress in support of legislation that would reverse the administration's decision. America is a better place when we are free to love God. Please join with me in ensuring that this assault on religious liberty is overturned. Asking God's blessings upon you through the intercession of our patroness, St. Anne, I remain sincerely yours in Christ, the Most Reverend Alan H. Vigneron, Archbishop of Detroit. My brothers and sisters, let us stand and profess our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Trusting in God's great desire to give us all the gifts we need, we turn to him with these, our petitions.
Let us pray for the Church. God, you call us to live for your glory alone. Strengthen those who minister in your Church. Reward our parish volunteers for their generous service. We pray to the Lord. Let us pray for our leaders and our nation. May our God-given right to freedom of religion and the freedom to follow our consciences be protected and promoted by our national, state, and local leaders. We pray to the Lord. Let us pray for those who have fallen on hard times. Lord Jesus, in your mercy and compassion, bring healing and comfort to those who have lost jobs, homes, and the means for caring for those they love. We pray to the Lord. Let us pray for the sick. Healing Savior, cure with your mercy our friends and loved ones who cry out to you. George Owens, Anita Dudley, Jason Lloyd, Joey Coretti, Madeline Tucker, and for those who suffer with conditions that make it difficult to cope with day-to-day life, we pray to the Lord. Let us remember the dead. Risen Lord, fill our loved ones with the joy of everlasting life, especially Phyllis, Gary, and Randy Party. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us pray for our personal needs in silence. Loving God, help husbands and wives to be living signs of your tender and faithful love. Be with those who are struggling with hurt, discord, or hardships. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the great gifts you give us. Give us the strength and courage to be witnesses of your love in this world. We ask all these prayers through Christ our Lord.
Even the
search me and you know me. All my thoughts lie open in your gaze. When I walk or lie down, you are before me. Ever the maker and keeper of my days.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May this oblation, O Lord, we pray, cleanse and renew us, and may it become for those who do your will the source of eternal reward, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he, blessed is he who comes in the name.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
There Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Benedict our Pope and Alan our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom of God. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. And with your spirit. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Him who takes away the sins of the world, blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. Thank you.
to share our story. We come to break the bread. We come to know our rising from the dead. We come as your people. We come as your own, united with each other, love finds a home. We come to share our story. We come to break the bread. We come to know our rising from the dead. We are called to heal the broken, to be hope for the poor. We are called to feed the hungry at our door. We come to share our story. We come to break the bread. We come to know our rising from the
Let us pray. Having fed upon these heavenly delights, we pray, O Lord, that we may always long for that food by which we truly live, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. In Marion Hall, you will find new tags on the boughs of blessing tree to benefit the homeless in Pontiac. A sign-up board to serve the homeless by volunteering at the Hope Warming Center in Pontiac. Please see the Voice for news on our parish pilgrimage, including our parish retreat, Following the Footsteps of Jesus with Father Alex Kratz. Also in the Voice, this weekend you will find the letter from Archbishop Vinron that was read during Mass today. Our Archbishop has asked us to particularly be aware of this vital issue of religious freedom. More information can be found at the AOD website and at the website for the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops. This letter also is available on our website. The Bottles for Babies campaign, which benefits the ministry of the Oxford Pregnancy Center, concludes next Sunday, February 19th. Please return all bottles, filled or unfilled, to the baskets at the church doors or to the parish office. Doing God's work together, caring for babies born and unborn, is truly a blessing. And lastly, Oxford High School Choir will join with Grand Haven Chorale Ensemble and Rochester College Choir to perform Sunrise Mass at the Oxford High School Performance Arts Center on Saturday, February 25th at 7 p.m. Tickets will be available at the door for $7 or $5 for students.
This issue with the HHS mandate is changing at times. It's still developing, so I do invite you to stay up to date on it through the Archdiocese website or the USCCB website. Thank you, Kathy. It's been a joy for me to work with Kathy since I've been here, not just because she's great at what she does, but because she's a fellow Tigers fan as well. So I invite all married couples to stand for a special blessing tonight. My dear friends, you once stood before the altar of God and solemnly vowed your love to each other. You were married in Christ, and Christ has continued these many years to be your portion in happiness and your chalice in sorrow. We beg him to guide you and watch over you, helping you to persevere in fidelity and love for the years ahead, which we pray will be many and blessed. Lord God and Creator, we bless and praise your name. In the beginning you made man and woman so that they might enter a communion of life and love. You likewise bless married couples that they may reflect the union of Christ with his church. Look with kindness on these married persons today. In the midst of the joys and struggles of their lives, you have preserved the union between them. Renew their marriage covenant, increase your love in them, and strengthen their bond of peace, so that surrounded by their children and grandchildren, they may always rejoice in the gift of your blessing. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite everyone to stand now. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life. Thanks be to God.
My life flows on in endless song, above earth's lamentation. I hear the real, the far-off hymn that hails a new creation. No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since love is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing? I hear that music ringing. It sounds and echoes in my soul. How can I keep from singing?